I'm Luke Summerhayes.
I'm James J. Miles.
I'm James the Jasper Stewart.
And you're listening to Monster Mash.
And on this week's episode, we are hunting Bishaten.
Jas is back and Muss is gone, so people are going to really think there's beef.
The Monster Mash.
The Monster Mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
They played the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They played the mash.
They played the
a monster with a distinctive tail. While it is omnivorous, it has a preference for fruit and keeps various fruits with all kinds of effects in its belly pouch. An incredibly curious beast, it enjoys playing tricks on people, and has been seen to bat fruit at its prey using its tail.
On the road to perdition stands a false sentry with a devilish mission. Once it spots movement, it puts its tail in position. Its plan to pelt prey coming into fruition. For this is its territory. And there is no admission.
I love this lad. This is my... now that I've been for the whole game, obviously, I think Woolly Monster I've probably not fought is the new story monster, but this is my favourite of the new boys. Mm. Oh, I love it.
Like that description of him, like, is bang on as well. Like, and you see that throughout the fight.
Just that.
It's definitely a fun one.
I think what I really like about him is, I mean, and all the new monsters have this. Don't get me wrong, but I think Bishaten was the one that, when he started moving, he's like one of the most visually arresting fights. Like, we've had monsters that kind of balance on their tails before, like Great Macau, he's one of them, and I think Ketchawatcha did it as well, if I remember rightly.
A little bit, not
yeah,
so
it
much.
Hangs
yeah.
on like vines upside down.
It hangs on the vines. Similar, well, a monkey monster, right? So similar sort of vibes. But this guy, like, when you see him like breakdancing and twirling and whirling about the place, like I remember the first fight, I was just spent the whole battle going, whoa,
yeah,
just like in amazement with him, like how incredibly dynamic it was when he like him flying about the battlefield, which, you know, coming from maybe some more cumbersome monsters that we spoke about in recent weeks, like Tetranodon, for example, which still great fights, don't get me wrong, but you know they are big lads that don't really move about to the same degree as Bishaten does. Yeah, it was just a nice surprise to see a monster flying about like this.
Yeah, it's definitely up there. I always like the ones who sort of can move around and dodge you and have a bit more of a fight with you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like he's toying with you the entire time, because you don't know what he's going to do. Like, even like when you first like fight him in the Shrine Ruins, like if you're down in that first area where the Totori Tower is, or whatever it's called. I think it's called that.
Mm.
Like, he hangs on that, like he does in his cutscene, like when you first, like...
Yeah.
There's something you can do that, and like, you can do it on, like, normal walls as well, where you just, like, back through
oh, the, from there. Do you mean the Tori Gate?
The Tori Gate, that's the one. Yeah.
Talking about Keebly, you've got Totoro in your head.
Totoro
Gate.
I was going to say as well, I really like the fact that, like, he's a fang beast, and... I really like the fact that they took a chance with his design as well, like making it like not the typical fang beast design, which are your Rajans or like forgetting the other ice monkey.
Blangonga,
yeah. Kongalala. When you first look at Bishaten, you would think he was a flying wild.
He's the first fanged beast who can fully fly, right?
I
think so.
Can he fly?
Ketchawatcha does like that glide.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think he's closer, like in, you know, genealogy, if you were to say that about Monster Hunter, to Ketchawacha, whereas, you know, the Kongalalas and the Rajans are more like apes, like big apes, like gorillas and so on. Whereas Bishaten, he's a cheeky monkey. Specifically, he's like he's also got a little bit of a fruit bat in him though as well. Obviously, with the
oh well, there's a whole bunch of like really interesting origins for Bishaten, which I'm sure we'll get into later.
Yeah,
but yeah, there's definitely. I mean, with Ketchawacha, I felt it was kind of like a flying squirrel vibe, but with Bishaten, I definitely get more of a bat vibe.
Yeah. But there's also that kind of monkey element with the tail, and obviously the whole cheeky.
Oh yeah, he's clearly overall a monkey, I think.
Yeah, and like the cheekiness of that, you know, like I think sometimes it's nice to have a monster who you just feel like it's just being a little shit, compared to like something that's like actively trying to murder you or scare you off. This guy's just like, oh, some hunters have walked into my domain. I'm gonna play a prank and I'm gonna throw some fruit at them. See how they feel about that. Even though that fruit could end up killing you, but you know, to him, he's playing. You know, he's having a silly laugh.
Is he Monster Hunter's Patches?
Yes, yeah, exactly. should have had a there's shinies on the ground leading up to like a cliff face, and then he hits a bit of fruit, and you fall into a pit with like four Rajangs. That would have been a good start to the fun.
Four sleeping Rajangs, and then he wakes them up by hitting them with fruit.
Yes.
I just want him to have Patches' voice. I love Patches' voice. Never trust an onion.
That'd be a scary thing, though, when the monsters could talk.
One of them just suddenly talks to you.
Oh, dearie me. Might to cut this out for spoilers, but it'd be like the bit in Attack on Titan when the beast starts speaking.
Like what would a Rajang say? What would a Rajang actually be saying when he fires these hyper beam?
Fuck off!
Have a bit of this.
The Rajang would just be very angry all the time.
Is the Rajang angry or is he just loving it?
I think the Rajang's pissed as fuck. He's raging. Yeah. Furious Rajang.
True.
Oh, right. That's the variant.
Furious George.
Furious George versus the Furious Rajang.
I mean, we spoke about how he kind of like, you know, flips and flies around the battlefield, so to speak, but I do like the different fruit elements that you can use. Like, you know, he's obviously got the orange one, which is just a range attack pretty much, and the purple, the poisons. But I really, one of my favorite moves he does is where he kind of uses wings and kind of like peeks and kind of like, you're like, what's he up to? And then he just chucks up like a yellow flash fruit at you basically, and ruins your day with essentially what's a flash bomb. It's just a really, really, again, cheeky, very cheeky move, very sly and tricksy, tricksy Bishaten, which I just love about how much character they've injected into this guy, like through his movesets. You know, you can say a lot of things about Bishaten, but I don't think you could ever call him a boring fight just by how much character the monster has.
Well, it reminds me of Blangonga used to do Kongalala used to do the thing where he had all the mushrooms and he'd eat them and do the different element parts. Whereas this takes that and does it in a slightly less gross way.
Well, haven't you said before like that Japan really likes like toilet humour?
Oh, yes. Yeah, we talked about Volvadon not that long ago.
That's right. That's right. So Kongalala very much fits that to a T, right? Whereas Bishaten is a monster that can be enjoyed by all.
I do like as well like those fruit attacks that you mentioned, like there's like he's got those three you mentioned, like they're really kind of playful. They'll obviously do damage to you, but they're more kind of playful. And he's got that his real kind of nasty attack is when he does the paralysis fruit one.
Yeah,
because he does like a tail slam at the same time, and all the paralysis like smoke comes out, and like you get caught in that, like you can easily guard you from that.
That's when he's like, okay, you're like, playtime's over. I'm fucking sick of this. Get away. And he hits you with that.
He's also absolutely nailed me with his fruits a few times.
Oh, yeah. Like, they do a bit of damage.
There's a big thing in Rise that, of course, you can always just get on your dog and, like, go and safely heal and sharpen and stuff. But I've just been, like, doing a nice, lazy, wide circle around him while I sort myself out, and he's just nailed me with an orange.
It happened, like, when we were doing the hunt before, like, I was playing Insect Glaive, and, like, any time I was, like, flying through the air, I got pinged out of the sky a couple of times.
And I always, like, I know there's a few monsters, I think maybe Kongalal is one of these you can do it with as well, like, just speaking of them earlier, but I do like monsters where you can get, like, drops from them that benefit you. So, because obviously you can knock Bishaten's fruit out of its hands, and
and
then pick them up for what's kind of like between a potion and a mega potion, if I remember rightly, for the orange fruits, and then you can get essentially what are like poison knives, for want of a better word, with the poison fruit as well, which is a nice little bonus.
I do like it, but it is always disappointing when you see like, whoa, so many shinies. And then, like, 60% of them are fruit.
I guess if you're newer to Monster Hunter, and this was you were having difficulties with this fight, perhaps, this is a nice little bonus to you, that if you learn the fight and you know when to knock him over, like when he's balancing on his tail, you maybe use a few potions up and you get rewarded with, you know, potions to help you out for the rest of the fight. You're like, yes, bonus result. Whereas for us, it's just, you know, visually appealing, seeing a ton of shinies on the ground, but maybe not something that we need, so to speak.
Yeah. Well, and in keeping with all of the fruit business and the, you know, sharing it around, the Bishaten armor, it gives you the, I don't know if it's explicitly wide range, but it gives me something where when I heal you guys.
I'll be wide range then, yeah, yeah.
I haven't looked, but yeah, I assume that's what it is on this one.
That would make sense. Yeah, it has to be wide range.
Yeah, wide range. And item prolonger.
Ah, very, very fitting for the Bishaten.
Yeah. Plus it looks really nice. Looks very comfortable and furry.
Like, the armor on these weapons are some of the best looking in the game, I would say. It's just a little bit of a shame, though.
I think all the new monsters have banging armor in this game.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I'm just saying, like, Bishaten's, like, for me, like, I think the design's just, like, it's up there. Because it's not your usual. It's not like anything
it was the first,
you've seen in previous games.
It was the first full high rank set I made, and I used it for quite a bit.
Nice. So we kind of touched upon it a little bit earlier there about its designs and so on. Obviously, from the natural world, we've got kind of like, you know, a monkey or with a fruit bat as well, very much a key inspiration, I would say. But is there anything else that you've picked up on your research there, Lucky Boy?
Well, its name is Bishaten, but in Japanese, its name is literally Bishatengu.
Oh, well.
It's based on the Tengu.
Wow, okay. Well, there we go.
Yeah.
On the nose there.
Yeah, so the Tengu is, I mean, probably the only yokai more famous than the Tengu are like the kappa, right? It's the either it's depicted as a big red bird, or more recent years, like it's a human face with a long ass red nose, like instead of a beak. And for most of Japanese mythology, the Tengu are like one of the major bad guys. They just turn up and act like dicks. They're like demons. But they're more, there are other sort of villages and stuff where they worship Tengu as like guardian gods. But yeah, mostly they're just, they got wings, they got a beak, and they're going to be dicks to you. So he kind of is acting like a Tengu.
Yeah.
In terms of like so visually, he's, no. Well, a lot, sometimes they're just sort of tricksters and stuff. Like the Oni are the ones who will just like kill you and eat you.
But they're the demons.
Whereas Tengu are just going to fuck about with you. But like if you look at the Tetranodon, it's like so obviously a kappa.
Yeah.
Whereas Bishaten is a little more subtle in taking Tengu elements. Like it's got the wings, it's got a beak, but it's not like really,
it's not
over the top about
one
it.
Where you'd expect
other than its name. in Japan.
I think I did see like on Twitter at some point, like there was like early concept art of Bishaten, and I think they did give him like more of a like longer like snout. I think it looked like it looked really.
I did see a lot of fan art. I don't know if I'd seen any concept art, so that's.
Yeah, it made me fan art as well. Like, but like, if it was concept art, like it was probably they probably just thought, oh, this is too close to Ketchawatcha. Obviously, Ketchawatcha.
Oh yeah, because he's got like he's got a long nose.
He's more like a flying squirrel and eel like type.
Well, the one I saw was before they'd even announced Bishaten, and people were speculating about having a Tengu monster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that's because they dropped the director. Like, yeah, done little drawings and he dropped like a hint and drew a little Tengu face.
But also, because it's a blue monkey with a hand on the end of its tail, it really reminds me of Apom from Pokemon.
Yeah, I can see that. Again, also like a cheeky little shit, right?
Yep, yeah. That's why he's my brother's favourite Pokemon. But it feels like there should be some common ancestor, right? If both these companies have made a blue monkey with a hand on the tail. But, like, looking... I googled it furiously for this podcast and for my Pokemon podcast. There doesn't seem to be some precursor in, like, mythology or anything. The closest I could find was some Aztec god, but that's sometimes a monkey, sometimes a jaguar. I think it's just... I think in Pokemon's case, it was just... Well, monkeys kind of use their tail like a fifth limb.
Like a tool. Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
So let's make it literal.
They're just elaborating on the fact that a monkey uses it as a tool.
I wonder if Monster Hunter is deliberately homaging Pokemon a little bit. Because it is very similar. But then Ketchawatcha kind of had a hand on its tail.
I guess because... It's not explicitly a hand with Bishaten. It's more like a big lump, right?
I think it's got kind of fingers.
Kind of got claws.
Well, and also because the Bisha part of its name comes from hand and tail.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Thanks to my friend Swadder again for that one. I hit him up.
Hey.
And there's one more inspiration which I only know about because I happened to listen to the Myths and Legends podcast on this very story a few weeks back. Have you heard the Japanese fairy tale or fable, whatever you want to call it, of the monkey and the crab?
I have not.
Oh, well, okay, so there's a monkey and a crab and they're good friends and they both find a persimmon. And the crab decides that he's going to plant his and he's going to grow a tree and have many persimmons. But the monkey, being a monkey, is impatient, so he just eats his persimmon there and then. And then, you know, years go by and the crab works hard and grows a nice big persimmon tree. And finally, it fruits for the first time. The crab goes, oh, I'm a crab. I can't climb the tree. So he asks his good friend, the monkey, to help him. And the monkey agrees. He climbs up the tree. And then when he gets up there, he's like, well, I could just eat all these persimmons myself. So he starts chowing down on them. And the crab's shouting out, like, what are you doing? What are you doing up there? Where's my persimmons? So whenever he finds one that's like underripe and it's like hard and firm, he chucks them down at the crab and manages to smash the crab to death with them. And then later, the crab's son declares revenge on the monkey. But
if you made this up, that was like a sudden turn.
Feigns ignorance, invites the monkey to dinner, ambushes him and slices him up to death.
What a lovely children's tale.
I know, I love it because
like, that was going so well until that point. Like,
I was expecting like a fable or like a like the. You
it
know,
it is a fable. It means avenge your father's death. This is a fable that the samurai culture came up with, you know?
Yeah. I was definitely thinking this is something very much born of the samurai, you know, for fuck's sake. Oh, dearie me. I was expecting like a tortoise and the hare sort of ending here. But...
I know, right?
Or like the monkey like finally like learning his lesson from like killing the poor crab.
Well, he certainly fucking
learned
his lesson.
Oh yeah, he does learn his lesson.
Obviously, he eventually did. But yeah, but, like, I thought I was just going to end there, like, and obviously he was like mourn the crab and realise what he had done.
So let's keep our Bishatens away from our Cenotaurs then, yeah?
Yep.
Jesus Christ.
The Dymo Hermitors,
Yeah.
I'm surprised we didn't get those two just because they've got, like, big samurai words in their names.
Maybe for an expansion. Maybe for an expansion.
I was talking to Andy last time. I've got a theory about the expansion.
What do you reckon?
I think they're going to go with Chinese influences instead of Japanese.
Okay.
Based entirely on the fact that they haven't used Kirin yet. And Kirin's kind of exist in Japanese mythology, but they're mostly from Chinese mythology. It'd be interesting if they did one that was a little more China-based. Okay. As the expansion.
So is it like, is it Chinese or is it Japanese when it's they call like Kirin's like the word for giraffe?
Kirin is a mythological creature, but then when the Japanese first saw giraffes, they were like, what the fuck? They were like, yeah, that's the Kirin's. Yeah, so Kirin is now the Japanese word for giraffe.
Brilliant.
Because, I mean, as Dave Turner's always says on the computer game show, imagine seeing a giraffe for the first time. Yeah. Like, what a wild thing.
You'd be convinced, man, like someone brings that back and they say, like, well, that's like a mythical beast. It's like a basically
you're right.
A version of a unicorn.
Like, I kind of had that experience a couple of years back. Up here in Nagano, there's the famous snow monkeys, right? The guy, little monkeys who sit in the hot springs. So I went up to visit them. And I'm walking up the mountain to get to them. And out of the woods just emerges this creature. And it's like, kind of like part wolf, part goat. And I've never seen anything like it in my life. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, have I just seen some sort of, like, forest god? So, like, I filmed it, and eventually I got home and I showed it to my then-girlfriend. She's like, oh, yeah, that's just this animal that only exists in Japan. And I, like, Googled it and found it. And I was like, I didn't know there were, like, more animals that I didn't know about. I thought at, like, 28 years old, that was done.
Yeah, that's crazy. Makes you wonder, like, other, like... parts of the world, you know, what kind of hidden animals you just don't know about.
I'm really glad, though, like, to know that I don't know all the animals yet, because it's always fun learning a new animal.
Mm.
Yeah. I've also forgotten what it's called, so I can't even mention it now, which would have been a satisfying end to that story.
The main event of Friday Night SmackDown, and Jay, the main one, Miles' face is painted with a frown, for his opponent is nowhere to be seen, and Jay is feeling pretty damn mean. Suddenly the ring rumbles and quakes, and breaks in half as Jay shivers and shakes. Erupting from below is a boulder most mighty looking. And Jay can indeed smell what this rock is cooking. Its pungent gas makes young Jay feel most meek. For it is Bessarios we are hunting next week. So join us for that one. I can tell you already, no spoilers, I won't be there. But Andy and Lucky Boy will be there. So make sure you tune in for a nice Bessarios cast.
In the meantime, you can find this podcast on Twitter at Monster Mash Pod. We're also on Facebook, YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. Anywhere where you can find podcasts, you can find us by searching Monster Mash Podcast. And please do give us a 5-star rating and a review and tell your friends. You know, help share the love. And if you're enjoying this podcast and you want to give it $1 a month and you hear episodes a little bit early, you can find this podcast and all my other podcasts at patreon.com/podcastiopodcastius. And, you know, if you think you need a little bit of extra to sweeten the deal before you join a Patreon, let us know what kind of thing you'd want to see. Do you want us to do, I don't know, fucking streams or something? Let me know by going over there, patreon.com/podcastiopodcastius.
And also make sure to tweet at Buskily what that weird wolf goat creature he saw in the woods was called. He'd really appreciate
it. I'm racking my brain, but I can't remember. It'll hit me like 10 minutes or an hour when I'm not recording. a Cero! It's called a Cero.
You're like, oh, I remember that monster's name.
But yeah, I just remembered. It's a Cero. Serrow.
Oh, well, fuck that tweet request now.
Yep. What you should do, listeners, is just look up Cero's because they're
like,
really cute.
Tweet it as it would be tweeting at Andy or look. Like
tweet
look.
Andy Man 949 now.
Tweet Andy Man 949, your favourite fruit based attack.
There we go.
Oh, I was wrong. It's only one R.
Until then, catch you next time.
Cheerio.
See ya. You want to ready up, boys?
Yeah, yeah.
Let's go hunt a Bishaten.
I'll give you a tip for the Bishaten, right? It flows through.
Right, lads, I'm going to tell you something. We're not looking for a rock. We're looking for a monkey.
Live by the sword, die by the sword.
There it is. Oh, he's a good lad, this guy. He's a good lad.
No, that's why I didn't want to see this one without you, because I know you dig him.
I do like him. I do like him. Oh, I've forgotten how to play this. It's been way too long.
I had the problem of literally putting down Bloodborne and picking this up. Although, for the most part, I haven't tried to press Bloodborne buttons in this. I've just tried to press the buttons from this.
Didn't as well. Try press X.
But I keep trying to run Bloodborne and then just swinging my axe.
Watch the Truman Show and get my dad's recovery.
The Truman Show?
Mm-hmm.
Good film.
It is a good film. Dad,
is this your first time?
No, I've seen it before, but not for ages. I've forgotten most of the main story beats. My dad hasn't seen it, which was crazy.
I could recommend a great podcast on the subject.
You done an episode on the Truman Show?
Yeah.
Sweet. We listen to that episode if we wanted to.
You can find that. Matt and Luke's Sci-Fi Sanctuary are all good podcasts to found. Or find us on Twitter at MLSFSpod.
I did that really shitty joke though after the film was done of like held up a can of Pepsi Max against his head and like did a Pepsi Max ad. He didn't get what I was doing. He was like, "What are you doing?"
Yeah, it sounds like a dad response.
I mean, getting him to pay attention to a TV show or film at the best of times is difficult.
Yep.
I don't know if it's just an older generation thing, because I definitely have the same problem with my mum and not with my brother or sister for watching something, but they just play on Facebook or Twitter, mostly Facebook, like whilst we're watching something. Like, fucking pay attention. Could you?
Oh, see, is that? You ask them, they'd say that's a problem with our generation.
I know.
But yeah, it's the whole thing. Like, they were all warning us that we're going to get addicted to the internet, and it's totally our parents who got addicted to Facebook. I've barely been on Facebook in like the past 4 years.
I use Messenger once in a blue moon, and that's about it.
I still have Messenger on my phone because it's the main way I stay in contact with a few different people, but I haven't had Facebook on my phone this whole year.
You've beaten the Zuckerberg menace.
I would like to beat Zuckerberg.
I'd say I've never had a Facebook
to death.
He would allegedly beat Zuckerberg to death.
No, explicitly. That is a threat.
There we go.
You can find this podcast on Facebook at facebook.com/monstermashpod. Where about two times in a year I remember to post the latest episode.
If, like, the about two times a year when I remember to actually log on to Facebook proper instead of Messenger, like, that's what the majority of my notifications are. So many people are noticing your Monster Mash page. You should buy an advertisement. I was also giving my brother a lift there and back from my dad's, and on the way back we had a good 30 minute passionate discussion about which JoJo's Bizarre Adventure opening was the best, whilst his girlfriend just looked on in utter dismay.
Anytime I have a group chat with my family, me and my brother just start discussing anime and no one else knows what's going on.
What's your favourite anime?
Yeah, like Ghibli stuff, like the Grave of Fireflies.
Straight in for the saddest one.
It's because it's the realest one.
Good night, sweet prince.
Good night, sleeps.
No monkeys were harmed in the recording of this.
I mean, he was pretty harmed.
I'd like to believe it was a nice massage for him instead.
He's got quite a fun sleep animation, actually. I don't know if I've seen that before.
It's a bit like Ragland, isn't it? Without the
Ragland.
Terrifying
little belly.
Scratch
the scratch and the terrifying looming threat in case it wakes up.